safe, durable, take advantage of what is there, avoid unnecessary trouble, and keep it simple and be effective. We have to understand why it failed and can you fix it. So prepare yourself and the patient for failures always. So plan for a revision surgery. Obviously, you should have your instruments, your armamentarium should be good. You should have the Oscars and reciprocating saws and high tension boards. So diagnosis and of PGI is very important, and diagnosis is very important because it is a there is no gold standard and no standard definition which is accepted, and you have so many investigations which can be helpful but not very true. So you should know about the early, delayed and late, because patients might present late and they will say that yes, infection did happen, but usually it happens in delayed cases due to hematogenous and spread from other distant infections. So this is a very important slide. We are still, however, a long way from the agreement of most of the basic questions of all, whether post-operative infection is acquired in the operating room or not. And this is very important, especially in the case of our scenario, because if you ask the patient's relative to stay out of the room, I mean the guard and the doctors might be abused as well. So diagnosis is important, and then we have three options. One is single stage, two stage, and one is diet, that is debridement and implant retention. So what is our goal of treatment? You should give an early diagnosis, you should identify the organisms if possible, you should aim to eradicate the infection and prevention of recurrence. This is also very important. And for this, you need a multidisciplinary team. It's not you alone, you need a multidisciplinary team, right from microbiologists to specialized orthopedic nurses. So obviously the first option and the second option is not what I'm going to talk about, but I would enlighten you about dire protocol, because dire means that you are doing a debridement and doing an implant retention. It has been described in various literatures in 2006 and 2004, but who are the candidates for a dire protocol? They should have a short duration of symptoms, well fixed and aligned functioning implant, organisms identified and they should be susceptible. They should have adequate soft tissue covers, especially in cases of knee, immunocompetent host. Again, the host should be classified according to Cierney and Mader classification, because if you have an immunocompetent, immunodeficient host, then you should think of revision, that is in two stage. So obviously you have people who don't do well. This has been published by Beverly et al. In 2006. So gram-negative MRSA and superbugs, that is known in the West. These are some prone that who don't do well with the diet. Second important thing is one stage revision. This has been traditionally dealt and explained by the endoclinic people. It basically involves only one operation. It has obviously a lower morbidity. There is no pain disability between two stages, and because you are doing two in one actually. There is no technical difficulties associated with delayed reconstructions. And obviously, if it is successful, it is definitely cost effective. But who are the candidates for the single stage? Obviously, non-immunocompromised patients. One thing which has been should be discussed here, both in case of dire and this, the organism should be known. And generally, we have an idea that we send for culture and sensitivity, but we just send it and it comes negative and then we don't bother. Ideally, it should go for an extended culture for 14 days. That is a cardinal rule. It should be a low virulent pathogen, and there should be no signs of systemic involvement. And obviously you should have limited osseous defect and soft tissue permitting wound closure, etc., etc. Obviously it is aggressive, and traditionally it is done in endoclinic. Now let's come back to my topic, that is a two-stage revision. First described by Insall in 1983, and the success rates, it varies from 85 to 100%. So what exactly is two-stage protocol? As a layman, we remove the prosthesis, because you have the collection or formation of biocalyx, and antibiotics are not permeable to that, and you place a high dose antibiotic cement spacer, and appropriate antibiotics are given for appropriate time, which is still debate, and then you re-implant to a newer prosthesis at a later time. And there are some variables which we need to discuss. types of spacer, type of antibiotics, length of the antibiotics, intravenous antibiotics and the oral antibiotics, and the most important thing is what should be the ideal time. So coming to the first stage, obviously in cases of knee, the most lateral longitudinal incision should be preferred, and before we are doing the antibiotics should be stopped for minimum of 2 weeks or at least a week, because you just can't go with an infection, and when you take out things, it would again, the cultures would be no sensitivity growth. And antibiotics and samples should be taken at least 4 quadrants, and minimum 3 to 4 samples should be taken. And as a cardinal rule in orthopedics, all histopathology should be sent for cultures and all cultures should be sent for histopathology. Just this should go one hand in hand. Obviously, when you are taking out the implant, you should do intramedullary rimming, and as told by Dr. Rohit Maheshwari, intramedullary rimming, saline pulse lavage is important, and some people, and it has shown in literature, that chlorhexidine gluconate is good to go for. Now, treatment variable, that is type of antibiotic, type of spacer and dose of antibiotic. So these are some examples of static spacers in which we just put a cement and we don't bother about the movement. With time, these are some examples in knee and hip. With time, obviously it has some advantages. You can just create it on table, because the prostalag, the cement spacers, that is mobile, it is costlier. It is this, and but the disadvantages are contracture of extensor mechanism, collateral ligament shortening, arthrofibrosis, tibial and femoral defect, bone loss, and potential difficulty in secondary exposure when you are using a static spacer. Sometimes even the static spacer dislodges, which I'll show you later. Now, coming to dynamic articulating spacers, as I told you, it is not available in Patna at the moment. You have to order it, and that is available by, it is available, but you have to get order it, and it comes with a price actually. And these are some examples of prostatic dynamic spacers. And advantages, you can actually walk on it. Patient comes with fully mobile on prostatic, and sometimes they demand that this is fine, I don't want a revision actually. And obviously they maintain joint motion, and it causes less periarticular scarring as compared to a static spacer. But as I told you, there are chances of spacer dislodgement, and still dislocation can happen in hips and knees as well. So what type of cement is used, what should be the antibiotic dose, and what combination can be used? These are the next three pertinent questions. So basically, Palapos cement has been shown to be the most cost-effective polymethylmethacrylate delivery device for antibiotic elution, and this has been quoted in several papers, which has been quoted in the references. Gentamicin loaded cement may not be appropriate for revision surgeries. This is also another thing. So for revision surgeries, ideally you now have rifampicin and etc. cements. So commonly used antibiotics for cement loading, gentamicin, clindamycin, we should know their susceptibility. Obviously, if you know the organism, it is better. And at the same time, there is a synergistic activity, because what happens, that tobramycin may synergistically increase the release of vancomycin. So this is, in general, they are helpful. So dose. So what is the dose? The minimum dose of antibiotics should be 2 grams of vancomycin, 2.4 grams of tobramycin or gentamicin, should be 4 grams of vancomycin and 4.8 grams in 40 grams of cement. So this also should be calculated, because if you put inadequate antibiotic with a spacer, that's of actually no use. So length of the antibiotic therapy. Second, one of the most important variable is length of the antibiotic therapy. And to be very fair and frank, there is actually no consensus whether how long we should give the antibiotics for, how long we should give oral antibiotics for, or intravenous, how long it should be continued and then shifted to oral antibiotics. Because different school of thoughts, for example, the Oxford group even says you should give antibiotics after the second stage for life at least a year. Some people say, some literature say, for 6 months. So you don't have a consensus, but it is important to be given. Obviously, it depends on the, based on the susceptibility. Empirical therapy should include a coverage of resistant Staphylococcus species, and the ideal answer at this stage would be 6 weeks of at least intravenous antibiotics should be given after the first stage. after the latest AOS guidelines, you can, after 4 weeks, you can shift to 2 weeks of oral, but still minimum 6 weeks of antibiotics, then 2 weeks of antibiotic free, and then go for the second stage. So time period, in general, as I told you, 6 weeks, and then wait for 2-3 weeks. But at the same time, you should have serial CRP, ESR monitoring, and it should come down. But you should understand as well that when does exactly the CRP comes down and ESR comes down. Because immediately post-operatively, the ESR and CRP, and even in pregnancy, the ESR and CRP is high. Sometimes patient develops a myocardial infarction, patient has been operated, shifted to other hospital, they say the patient is in septicemia. This is a common problem which has happened in my practice. So after being shifted, they say the patient is in septicemia. Fine. What would I like to ask the doctors? What is the, when the CRP level comes down? What is the literature evidence? So minimum 4 weeks, and there is a typical graph when the ESR and CRP comes down. So that should be noted. And when we obtain a CRP at least less than 10, ESR less than 10, then you should plan for your second stage of surgery. When it comes to the second stage of the surgery, it is very important to go back again and remove all the tissues which you feel that it might be necrotic. In cases of knee, even if you have to remove the MCL, remove it and then go for a hinge knee replacement. But the main purpose is you reduce the burden of any persistently infected tissues. And it allows the removal of cement abrasion debris, because cement has been kept and there must be some debris. So you should get rid of everything. And again, after the second stage revision, some papers say that antibiotics should be again given for 3 months to 6 months. What I still reckon and take home message would be minimum 3 months antibiotics should be at least given with close monitoring. Now, if I reconcile my talk, two-stage exchange arthroplasty continues in two-stage arthroplasty infection in some papers has been quoted to be still 67% to 91% of cases. And the combined rate of failure of multiple studies reviewing the results of two-stage reimplantation is 18%. So still, the gold standard described by INSAL, still it ranges from 9% to 33%. So then the option of either amputation or fusion is the next solution. So these are some data which I'd like to present from 2014, 41 revision arthroplasties for infection, 4 knees, 37 hips, time period 4.6 months between the first stage and the second stage. All the second stage patients are actually doing good as far as HSS and Knee Society score is concerned, and midterm follow-up are available and scores are statistically significant. These are some examples of primary complex cases, or in cases where we had to remove and put a spacer and simple stem was fine. These are some cases again where we put, this was a sequel of infection. But this is what routinely we do. If you see this x-ray, we took out the implant, put a metal spacer, and actually this, all the cement was removed by doing an ETO, and then it was barbed wire and we put a cement spacer. For it was for 4 weeks, 8 to 9 weeks, and then this was the second stage revision. We had to revise the ETO and did a long stem with this. Now this was a very good case where patient presented, I think it was 6 to 8 months after THR done elsewhere, and it was a Chandler stem, and we did an ETO, and these are the pictures of the second stage revision. This was again a case, a young lady whom with somewhere it was infected, and we took out the implants, put a spacer like this, and her results. So all the patients, what my father also tells, rifampicin, isoniazid, we actually add in the long-term at least prophylaxis. And AKT TB in India is very common. So I don't have much data about tuberculosis, but tuberculosis, it should be treated on lines of tuberculosis as well, empirical therapy, when you don't get any cultures. And what I would like to conclude is that you should take appropriate samples, number one. Number two, you should send for extended cultures and have a word with your microbiologist, proper collection, ultrasonification of the implants that has been discussed, that should be discussed. Ultrasonification should be done of the implants, and cultures should be sought after, extended cultures, and then antibiotics should be also discussed with the patient and the doctors as well. And at the end of the day, if everything goes fine, patients are actually good. One of my patient is a dancer, he teaches dance, and he's a dancer himself after doing a revision second stage THR. Any questions, please? Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Like serum procalcitonin and interleukin 1, and is it done in UK as well to
yes.
follow up these cases?
Yes, it is usually done. It was usually done, and IL-6, I think one and ALP, one more markers. The dual markers are there, which is, if you read the AOS guidelines, they have come up with interleukin 6 and one more marker, which I don't remember at the moment. But these are some new markers available, but not, it is not done in Patna.
Are they as
See,
they are very costly.
Yes, cost is another thing, but there is no gold standard diagnostic modality. Even the PETs can diagnose infection. But still sometimes bone scan negative and patient has infection. Sometimes bone scan positive, patient has no infection.
So is there a role for bone scan before doing the scan?
See, as per the AOS guidelines, there is level of evidence is not a very it's not very diagnostic. I mean bone scan, but still I get it done because it gives at least a clue. Yes. So basically, as far as our practice is concerned in Patna, simple CBC, ASR, CRP, bone scan. Obviously, PET scan affordability is an issue, but there are papers which show that PET scan also can diagnose infection. I don't know. I don't know much about it. And diagnosis, and what I would like to also say that the gold standard is two stage, because we have had patients whom we had microscopic evaluation of the fluid, and then we thought it might come up with one stage. But if something happens, you're not able to explain the patient. They are very skeptical. No, you did the infection. One stage I do not recommend in my settings. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir.
So is there any role for frozen section?
Yes.
During your for your decision making, whether you would go in for a revision at the same sitting or even when you're doing your second stage revision, do you do a frozen section to check if there's any residual infection or not?
Actually, the first thing is that you should send for culture and sensitivity and for histopathological diagnosis. I don't have the facility of getting frozen section in theater, but I do get the samples checked. But I think if anybody has an idea whether frozen section, it should be helpful actually.
No, in cases where there is some doubt, that is one of the recommended ways to go. And the defining criterion is 5 or more leukocytes in a high power field.
Yes.
That's the definition. So if you have the facility, it can be used.
Okay, my question is how much longer spacer can be left if the infection doesn't resolve, if it like proceeds longer than what you are expecting, how long can we retain it?
See, Ashwini, this is a very good question. See, as far as the book says that you should do serial CRP ASR, and I'm very sure CRP and ASR doesn't come less than 10 most of the time. And the spacer I have left maximum of 8 months, because the CRP hasn't come down, 10, 12, I think we should go in.
Just give you a scenario. There was a hip patient. We got the MRI. It was a avascular necrosis. There was slight effusion in the joint. The joint was painful. It was a young lady. We had planned for a THR. We opened it. There was aseous material. So we just changed the, we skipped that THR part. We put the spacer. We took tissue, send it for culture and also for gene export and histopatho. In gene export, it came to be MDR tuberculosis. Now the problem started that it was both rifampicin and isoniazid resistant. The patient is like now 3 months now. She has the spacer inside. She still has the pain. And the ESR, CRP, everything is high. And actually, we are now confused to remove the spacer.
The answer of this question is that in cases of tuberculosis, you have two phases, intensive phase, that is HS6, 2HR Z-ES and 6HS. So for the intense, after intensive phase is done with cover of AKT, if it is normal AKT tuberculosis, we do THRs. This is in Campbell.
Yeah, we have done tuberculosis.
And full bore 1 year AKT after that.
We can do up 2 months or even 1 month.
In MDR, TB, yeah. I don't know. I'm sorry for it.
Sir, my question is not that. We have also done total hip replacements after 2 months of ATT. This was a case of MDR-TB which was diagnosed after the operation.
Yeah.
We couldn't diagnose it earlier. The ESR-CRP was in fact normal preoperatively.
So, I mean, for your answer to how long will you leave the spacer in? So, if you're looking for antibiotics from the spacer beyond about 6 weeks, that's gone. Okay. So, if you are still not getting control of your infection, you really need to go in again and debride again. And if you're sure it's tuberculosis, then you can go ahead and do your DHR at the same time. Yeah, so but you have to find out what this thing is, drugs it's sensitive to.
You already have that, sir.
Yeah, so you
got the gene export done.
Yeah.
We have the data, it's rifampicin and isoniazid risk.
So it's sensitive to the other, so use the other drug, simple as that.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, a question for you. You will go for total hip replacement or any arthroplasty before covering the patient on anti-tuberculosis, but straight away you go for that.
Yeah.
Or
ideally,
if you
know already in advance, okay, yeah. There is a no harm, it is an elective surgery, there is a no harm giving ATT for 6 to 8 weeks, then do THR.
Right.
And
second scenario,
suppose in this situation, if you find out on the table,
yes,
you can come out even doing total hip arthroplasty on the same day and start, if you clinically think, start anti-tubercular drug. And later on, you send all the investigation, come, you change your few drugs among these 5 or 6 drugs.
If you have access to the microbiology at the time, before closing the hip, I would get a gram stain done if clinically you are suspecting infection in there. So you know exactly what you're going into.
Yeah.
And Dr. Mukhopadhyay, I'm very right about the spacer being there. You don't need to leave it for months and months. If something is either your markers are not getting right, there is something going on. It may not be that joint, it may be somewhere else. But you cannot rely on the markers increasing up and the spacer just lying there. Thank you very much. Great session.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I would invite Dr. Chandi Wagar, sir. And Dr. Kamaldeep, sir, facilitated the Dr. Chandi Wagar, sir. I would like to invite Dr. C.S. Adar, sir, to facilitate Dr. Suman Chatterjee, sir.